verses. And then today we're going to deal with exponential functions as a whole. All right, so 8.3 is exponential functions. All right, what makes an exponential function? The independent variable. The independent variable, we've been using that term since pre-algebra. The independent variable, which is the x variable, is the exponent. We've done these before. This first part is review. This we've done. So y equals 2 to the x. We've done stuff like this. You guys already have the graph on your paper. But how would you get it? First off, you have to expect the shape. You have to expect that shape. And you have to know that if in your XY chart you don't get that shape, you've made some mistakes. It's going to be that shape. I mean, it might be in a different place. It might be up here. It might go up a little bit more quickly. It might be upside down. But it's that shape. You got to expect that shape. And if you don't expect that shape, then you'll be in trouble. So XY chart. You know, the normal way a student would do this is they would start with 0. And you're doing 2 to the 0, right? And again, we know our exponent rules because we've had those since pre-algebra. We know anything to 0 power is 1. And that's that first point right there, right? 0, 1. And you're going to do a 1. And we all know 2 to the first power is 2. And that's that point right there, right? So the natural thing would be to do 2 next, and you do 2 squared, right? Putting the 2 in for the variable, and you get 4, and that's that point right there. And maybe you go even one more point, and you should, and you do 3, and you do 2 cubed, 2 times 2 is 4, times 2 is 8, and you get that point right there. Well, here's what happens if you're not expecting the shape. You draw, don't put this in your notes, just this part of the curve. And you can't do that. You've got to have the other part of the curve. So because you know the shape, you say, oh, I need some negative numbers. And again, since pre-algebra, we had the rule x to the negative a equals 1 over x to the a. Because now you have to do 2 to the negative 1. And since pre-algebra, I've been trying to tell you that it's 1 over 2 to the first. So negative 1 is a half. And that's that point right there, right? And so when you do one more, negative 2, you have 2 to the negative 2. So for clarity's sake, right, 2 to the negative 2 is 1 over 2 squared, right? Now, some of you aren't writing that. That's the most important thing, and then you're going to miss all the problems. It's like that was the most important thing I've done so far this morning, is these two right here, because that's where you'll goof them up and miss them. Because 1 over 2 squared is 1 fourth, right? And that's that point right there, and there's your curve. So, again, you got to expect the shape, and you got to be careful with your negative exponents. Those are the things that are getting in trouble. If you don't expect the complete shape, or if you mess up with the negative exponents. Again, we've done this before. All right, domain. What are the possible x values? This goes forever to the left. And though it's going up to the right steeply, it has forever to go right. So the domain is all the real numbers. Right? If you were going to write it as an interval, it'd be parentheses, negative infinity, comma, infinity, right? Close parentheses. So all the real numbers, or as an interval that way. However, what are the y values? The range, you could call y greater than 0. Or you could say as an interval, comma 0. I'm sorry, parentheses 0, comma infinity, parentheses. Parentheses 0. Because is the 0 included? Does the curve hit 0? No, not until infinity. And that line is actually an asymptote, and I'll talk about that again in a moment. Okay, so domain and range. You think in your mind, domain, all possible x's, range, all possible whys. Okay, so what are we going to do now? Apply the things that we've learned before to this scenario. Okay, so here's graphing form. H and K, right? Everything we graph, parabola, all that stuff. H is actually in with the exponent. Notice how H always goes with X. And look, if you want to, you can put a parenthesis here. You don't really need it, but you could. See, that looks familiar, right? X minus H. And of course, K is what's added on after you do everything else to move it up or down. And we know that stuff. If the absolute value of A, this is what this means. If the absolute value of A is between 0 and 1, right? That's what that means, 0 less than absolute value of A, less than 1. That means A is between 0 and 1. If that's the case, then the curve is flatter. Flatter. If the absolute value of A is greater than 1, it's steeper. Steeper. So let me show you on the bottom. If I wanted to go steeper, I'm just going to curve up more quickly, right? That would be steeper. Makes sense? And flatter, it, you know, goes more slowly, right? Flatter and steeper. Okay. So the A, absolute value, can tell us flatter, steeper. Similar parabolas, right? Making the connections, Ben? Similar to parabolas? You look like you're off in space. That's why I called your name. And the H and K, just like we've done, H is going to be the what shift? Vertical, the horizontal shift. I know I'll catch the other blank in a minute. The H is the horizontal shift, just like always, and the K is the vertical shift, just like always. And haven't we talked about a negative out in front of an A before? And what does it do? It's going to reflect or mirror that. I'm going to use green here. About the, x-axis. But you know what? More particular, because when you really start having these things shifted, it's really about the line y equals k. It's really about the line, because this thing can be shifted up or down, right? If it gets shifted up, then the mirror is it about that y equals where it flattens out part, flips upside down. Again, if it gets shifted down, it's not reflected about the x-axis. It's reflected that concept, but about that line. I'll show you that in a moment as we deal with that. All right, so here's a situation. You can do this a couple different ways. We're looking for you to be able to determine some things. All right, so first off, the absolute value of A is between 0 and 1. So we're expecting flatter in this function. Okay, we're expecting it flatter, right? Because A is 3/4. I'm expecting a horizontal shift of which way and how much? Say it if you know it. Come on, you got color. Which way are we going and how much? We're going one to the right, right? It's the H value. Look, we've done this parabolas. We've done this with everything. One to the right. And what's the vertical shift? Right? Two down or down two, right? Because of the negative two. H value is the horizontal shift. The K value is the vertical shift. Okay. So we expect those things. And I'll also tell you this, here's the asymptote. This thing approaches y equals negative 2. And we can come down here and in our green put a dotted line at y equals negative 2. That is going to be the line this one approaches. Okay, so let's see if we can understand what's going on. What I graphed was the base function. So if you look up here to the right, the one I just circled, what's the value of H? Zero. What's the value of K? What's the value of A? What's the value of, no, A is not the base. What's the value of A? What's the value of A? What's the multiplier of the base? 1. All right, so A is 1, H is 0, K is 0. That's the base model. You got a 1 for an A, you got a 0 horizontal shift, a 0 vertical shift. Again, that's the line. Let me just, let's go through and put in a few values. So I'm looking right here. So if you were to graph these, one way to do it is to use your knowledge of the shifts and graph it that way. And that's what I'm going to show you. I will tell you this, though. You can just simply graph it by doing your own XY chart, understanding the shape, and making sure you're filling all the values. Got it? All right, but I'm going to show you how to use the base. All right, so what's the base function? Y equals 2 to the x. 2 to the negative 2 is what? 2 to the negative 2 is 1/4. Okay? And that's that point right there. 2 to the negative 1 is 1/2, and that's that point right there. 2 to the 0 is 1, and that's that point right there. 2 to the 1 is 2, and that's that point right there, right? 1, 2. 2 squared is 4, and that's that point right there. And it heads up to 2 cubed, which is 8, and that's up here somewhere, right? Okay, so that's the base model. So we're starting out with a base model. Now we have the function we're going to graph. But all we're worried about right now is the a value. So watch what we're going to do. I'm going to take this 3/4, and I'm going to multiply it times every one of these values. Okay. 3/4 times 1/4 is 3/16. Three fourths times 1/2 is 3/8. You guys with me following what I'm doing? 3/4 times 1 is 3/4. All right, we can reduce here. 3/4 times 2 is 3/2. Again, if you can't do it in your head, write it out. I just did 3/4 times 2. 3/4 times 4 is, come on, think. 3/4 times 4 is 2, and 3/4 times 8 is, that was a 3, right? And 3/4 times 8 is 6. Again, you got to reduce it. If you can't handle that in your head, again, you take the time. But here's the point. We took the 3/4, the A, and multiplied it times the values of the base one in each place. That's all we did. Just multiply that out. Okay, so I'm with my red. I'm just putting points here. Negative 2, 3/16. All right, that's like way, that's about there, you know. We're not perfect, but it's somewhere in there, right? Down there somewhere. Negative 2, 3/16. That's like a little less than a quarter, 3/16. Hey, if you can't think in fractions, I'm sorry, I can't help you. 3/8, that's pretty close to a half. About there. 3/4 we can do, right? 3/4 of the way, it's about there. When x is 1, y is 1.5, we can do 1.5. When x is 2, y is 3, that one we can hit right on the money. And when x is 3, y is 6, which is that one. Just leave the points. Don't draw a curve. All I did was plot these points. Negative 2, 3/16, negative 1, 3/8, 0, 3/4, 1, 3/2, 2, 3, and 3/6. Okay, now do the shift. What is the h value? It's a 1. What is the k value? It's a negative 2. So don't fall asleep here and ask questions if you don't follow what I'm going to do right now. So don't do this in your notes, but let me just get your focus. I am right here right now, the first point to the left, that red point. Guys with me? And I have to, from that red point, I have to go to the right one and two down. Do you follow? This shift. So watch, I'm going to go to that point. I'm going to go, I'll show it this way, to the right one, right, and down two. Right, one to the right and two down, and I'm going to put the new point. And it's right about there, right? One to the right and two down. And now I'm going to go to the next point at negative one. And I'm going to go one to the right and two down. And it's about there, right? Because I'm doing the shift every time. One to the right and two down. Now I'm doing this point, one to the right and two down. One to the right and two down. Now I'm doing this point. One to the right and two down. Now I'm doing that point. One to the right and two down. And now I'm doing the last point. One to the right and two down. And this is our curve. And notice as it approaches y equals negative 2. Now that's a way to graph it using the shifts, okay? It's a way of graphing it using the shifts. However, you could, knowing the shape, make up your own XY chart and graph it just straight out with the XY chart without worrying about the base shape, without worrying about the A factor, and then doing the shift, okay? But you should have that concept of what all of that does. All right, the imaginary line that the function approaches is called the asymptote. A-S-Y-M-P-T-O-T-E. A-S-Y-M-P-T-O-T-E. And for this one, it was Y equals negative 2. Right, it's this line right here. A-S-Y-M-P-T-O-T-E, the asymptote. And it's y equals negative 2. In the base, it was y equals 0, right, the x-axis. If it shifted up 1, the asymptote is y equals 1. If it shifted up 100, the asymptote is y is 100. If it shifted down a half, the asymptote is y equals negative a half. It's whatever that vertical shift is. It's going to be the asymptote. And you always know that that line approaches that asymptote. That curve approaches that asymptote. Take it to infinity and it would hit it. All right, that's that one. Again, if you can't do it by doing the shifts, then just graph it by plotting in the values with an XY chart. So you have to have an idea of the shape and you have to have an idea of the shifts so you know where it's going to end up on your paper. All right, basic patterns. We've got a couple things of the same concept. The multiplier out front here, the A value in what we just did, is the initial amount. We could be talking about population. We could be talking about bacteria. We could be talking about your initial investment of money. You could be talking about a lot of things. It's the initial amount. The base, the B, or in this one, the 1 plus R, different form of the base. But it's both the base, right? What the exponent goes to. It's called the growth factor. And again, it's the B in the left one or the 1 plus R in the right one, right? The growth factor. The B in the left one, the base, or the 1 plus R in the right one. If the base is less than 1 or 1 plus R is less than 1, guess what? It's an exponential decay. You don't want your money to decay. If you have bacteria and you're infected, you want the bacteria to decay. If B is greater than 1 or 1 plus R is greater than 1, it's an exponential growth. If you're investing money, you want it to grow. If you have bacteria, you don't want it to grow. Population, our population is a growth right now, not good. China had the one-child policy, right? Trying to get their population to go down. The general things, we'll talk more about them in the next lesson. All right, so here's an interesting formula. It's a compounding formula. P is the principal. It's the initial investment or the initial amount you borrow. R is the rate. Could be the annual percentage rate, etc. T is the time in years. So you got P is the principal, the amount you invest, the amount you borrow. R is the rate, APR. T is the time in years. Now N is in two places. And N is the number of compounds per year. Number of compoundings is the way I should say that. Number of compoundings per year. You can compound yearly, N would be one. You could compound monthly, N would be 12. You could compound semi-annually, 2. You could compound quarterly, N would be 4. We follow? Those are the normal ones. Most banks, you compound monthly. You could compound daily, N would be 365. There's actually even a compound continuously formula. All right, grab your calculators. You got to go a little quick here. Let's suppose when you were born, a grandparent or an uncle or aunt put $8,000 in a money market account for you at 9% interest compounded annually. Now, I think everybody's older than 15 here, so maybe close. When you would have been 15, let's figure out how much money you would have in that account. Principal comes first, parentheses. 1 plus 0.09, right? Remember, percents are always in decimal form in formulas. We're compounding monthly, so the bottom number is 12. And then the exponent is 12 times 15. So you're going to have to use some parentheses here. I like to do the exponent part first. Here's how I punch it in. 0.09 divided by 12 plus 1, and I equal that. Then I do my exponent to the parentheses 12 times 15, and by the way, and then multiply it times 8,000. All right, so see if you can run the numbers on that. 8,000 begin with. No more money put in that account whatsoever. 15 years later, if they were able to get 9%, and 15 years ago, you may have gotten 9%. May have been possible. Anybody got a number? Jeff? Nope, low. You're way low. Josh? $30,704.35 is how much you would have in that account at age 15. $30,000. Could buy a car. Could go to college. Well, for a year or two. $30,704.35. Okay, for time's sake, I'm going to tell you what would happen at 21 years. You'd have 52,000. And I'm just going to do 52K and change. Actually, 52.5. You waited till you were 30. Here's the miracle of compounding. You'd have $117,844.61 if you waited till age 30. So wait till you're 21, you got 52 grand. One time $8,000 investment. Wait till you're 30, you got 117 grand. Wait, you say, hey, you know what? I'm just going to wait till I'm 45. $452,292.71. One time $8,000 investment. See, you're on that curve, right? We're on that curve going up. It's exponential growth. So you say, you know what? I'm just going to let it ride. I'm going to go till I'm 65 retirement age. What do you think you got? You got $2,717,895.42 from that one time 8,000 bucks that your uncle or grandparent stuck in an account for you at 9% compounded and monthly. Amazing. Amazing. The miracle of compounding. 8 grand became 2,700,000. You know what most people do? They spend it at 15. No, probably 18 is like, it's probably like, you can't touch it till you're 18. And then at 18, it's still going to be what? Like, you know, 40 grand. So they're going to say, that's it. I got 40 grand. I'm spending that. But if you wait, there you go. All right. You got your lesson there. I know I went a little fast. Use your book. It's there to help you as well. It's a good book these days. Get things figured out.